Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the Planning Committee. It's 6 o'clock. My name is Stuart Kelly, I'm the Chair of the Committee. Can I please ask that all mobile phones are turned off or silent? This meeting will be webcast and a record retained on the Council website. The cameras are set to follow the microphones, so if members would please remember to use the microphone when speaking. If the applicant, petitioners or agents do not wish to be filmed, please let us know before you take the seat to speak. My role is to ensure that the committee runs smoothly, having regards to procedure, behaviour and ethics. To explain who the rest of the people are, to my right is the council solicitor, who will give advice to the committee on procedural and legal matters that may arise, along with the minute taker and webcaster. To my left are the planning officers, highway engineers and environmental health officer, who will present the applications and provide any technical advice that may be required. The other sides of the tables are the elected members, who will consider the applications and collectively make the decisions. Voting will be by show of hands. Each application will be introduced by the planning officers. Where there is a qualifying petition of 25 signatures or more, I will invite a representative of the petitioners to address the committee for 5 minutes. I will then invite the applicant or their agent to also address the committee. Statutory and local consultees may also address the committee. A ward councillor can also address the committee. Once representations have been made, and following any questions of clarification committee members may have, the speaker must return to the public area and may not participate in any debate that follows within the committee. The application will then be open to debate and discussion by members of the planning committee, and we will make a decision on the application. When making decisions, members may only have regard to material planning considerations. It's a matter for each member individually to balance these considerations and to decide what weight to give them. Members will also have regard to our local planning policies and to the national planning framework and guidance. The order of tonight's agenda will be varied depending on the number of people in attendance for a specific item. So, item one. To approve the accuracy of the minutes of the meeting held on the 16th of January. Any issues? Everyone happy? Can I sign the minutes? Item two, members' code of conduct, declarations of interest. Members of the committee are asked whether they have any personal or prejudicial interests in connection with any application on the agenda, and if so, to declare them and to state the nature of the interest. George.
Thanks, Hugh. Thank you. I'd like to declare an interest in items 5 and item 6. Due to my involvement, member of the cabinet, member for housing, I had a lot to do with the introduction of this and with the talks that went on around the time.
Thanks so much, George. So in terms of the agenda order then, or the agenda items, I'm advised that agenda item number 4 is being withdrawn or deferred by an officer's request to consider further consultation responses, so that one will be withdrawn. That means we have two substantive issues, first one being Rough Ferry and the second being Wings Lane. Petitions are here and in position for Rough Ferry High School. From our agenda as a process, so it's strictly speaking just deferred. We have two agenda items to deal with Rock Ferry. We will take them both together in terms of the discussion and debate we have. I presume we will have separate votes on each of them. One is the application proper, and the other one is the consent. The reports are there to attend. We have petitions, which are listed in the report. we have a petition from Susan Dodd, is it? Which is 294 respectively, part of being online, part of being paper, if you like. We have another of 96, which has been submitted by representatives of the Residents Association. And we have another petition of 35 names from residents of Ravenswood Avenue. Are the people that are made in front of the committee the lead petitioners for each of those three petitions?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Yes. So, full members. What I intend to do, because the petitions raise, in my mind, different matters to do with the application, is to ask the petitioners to address us in order of the size of petitions. So we will start off with Susan Dodd, then we will go to the Residents Association, and then we will hear from David Miller from Ravenswood Avenue. Each petitioner, or each group of petitioners, will have up to 5 minutes to address us. I will just say to those, if you like, follow the first address. There will be no need, if you like, to repeat points that have been raised. It would probably be sufficient to agree with what's been said. But if you wish to raise new matters in the same sort of way, that's fine. For the developer, I see behind us, the developer will get the same amount of time that collectively the petitioners use up after their 5 minutes. Are members content with that approach? I've emailed spokesman to advise that I was that was the way I wished to approach. I think that in the interest of fairness, that's the way forward. So we'll start as usual then with the officers introducing the item.
Thank you, three chair. If I deal with item number five first, then so planning permission is for the erection of an extra care scheme, the conversion of a listed building into residential use, and the erection of additional dwellings with associated access, car parking and landscaping. The development comprises of three parts: the erection of an extra care facility providing 102 units located at the northeast corner of the site, the conversion of the Grade 2 listed Ravenswood into 8 apartments, and the erection of 76 dwellings across the rest of the site. The site will be developed by a registered social provider and therefore will be 100% affordable. The tenure proposed will be a mix of shared ownership and affordable rent, and the site will be developed with accommodation ranging from 1 to 4 bedroom properties. The development will provide for 10 bungalows, 66 houses, 102 extra care apartments, together with 8 apartments within the existing listed building. And this equates to a density of some 37 dwellings per hectare. Separation distances within the development and in relation to neighbouring properties surrounding the site are acceptable, minimising the potential for overlooking or loss of privacy. Defensible boundary planting is proposed together with the retention of a number of trees around the perimeter of the site. The woodland area to the east of the site will be largely retained but thinned out to allow for a woodland walk to be created. The scale and density of the proposed development is considered to be appropriate for the location, and the design of the dwellings is also considered to be acceptable. Access arrangements and parking provision are also considered to be acceptable and not to interrupt the impact on the surrounding road network. The proposals represent the redevelopment of a vacant site, the long-term reuse of a listed building, and the provision of affordable housing that improves the offer for residential accommodation in this area. Taken on balance, these are all considered to be significant factors that weigh in favour of the proposed development, which is recommended for approval. There are 4 qualifying petitions of objection. In terms of item 6, then, which deals with a listed building consent application for the conversion of Ravenswood, this is a Grade 2 listed building and will be converted into residential use. The property will be converted into 8 apartments, which forms part of the proposals for the redevelopment of the wider Rockbury High School. The units will be 100% affordable and are all proposed to be 1-bedroom properties. The property sits in the centre of the wider site, and the proposed development will open views of this historic building both within the site and from the adjacent highway Highfield South. The proposal would bring about a sympathetic reuse of this heritage asset that would secure its long-use retention. The application is also recommended for approval, and there are four qualifying petitions and objection on this one also.
So, starting in petition size order, we start with the petition submitted by Susan McDonald. If you could introduce yourself to us, if you press the centre button, looks like a face with this.
Yeah.
If you pull that, if you towards yourself so it can pick up your voice, they're not. Okay. I certainly can't, so hopefully everyone can. Okay, so if you could introduce yourself to us, and then you'll have up to 5 minutes to speak to your position. Okay.
Cherished asset to the community. In the absence of a tree policy, a good number of trees were removed during demolition. The tree report claimed that 11 trees ought to be felled, but we firmly believe that this might be the start of something more. And whilst there's talk of mitigation planting to offset climate change, we believe this is misleading. It's the old ground trees that soak up carbon and fills up the nuisance. We ask that the developer save all the trees and add to the rockberry trees planted, and plant many more. We know that £600,000 in grants have been made to plant trees in Wirral, and we think this illustrates the shortage of trees in our area. As wildlife live on the ground, it is vital that the ground and understory is protected, and we recommend that the woodland path is not constructed. We would like to remind you all that Wirral Borough Council has said it is committed to the climate change emergency, and tackling climate change starts here at home by protecting nature. The proposed flats have design concerns. The flats are one solid, bulky mass and will be overbearing. They are out of scale and out of character in terms of appearance. Architectural detailing and materials are seen on paper lack inspiration. As there is a shortage of social housing, we think it would be better if houses replaced flats. After all, Rockberry has a high number of homes, flats and sheltered accommodation. We want this development to be carbon neutral, with all dwellings to be built to the highest environmental standards. The proposed retail facilities at the base of the flat we think will take away much needed business from the independent shops on Baker Hill and Old Sheffield Road. These are a very short walk from the tourist site. The 50 space car park is not environmentally friendly, and should the flats get the go ahead, a better suggestion would be basement parking, giving more room for houses and trees. All the junctions around the site are severely stretched in traffic. Added traffic from the tourist site will add considerably to the congestion already experienced there. There was no traffic report on the Highfield South and the Old Chester Road junction, and we ask please that this is carried out. The high number of flats and houses on the site will generate tidal traffic both day and night. On balance, we feel the traffic report cannot be considered accurate or fair. In terms of pollution, research shows that pollution in Rockberry is very high. Particulate matter, that's particles above the World Health Organization annual limit of 10 micrograms per meter cubed, are according to the government commission model from Wirral. So at peak times, in some weather conditions, particulate matter will be several times higher, impacting on those suffering from chronic respiratory diseases, pregnant women and children. Urban regeneration is only safe with an investment in green barriers such as hedges and trees. As far as Ravenswood House goes, we recommend that there be no alterations to the perimeter walls and that the original gateway at Highfield South is preserved as a historic feature in its own right, and that refurbishments to the Ravenswood House are carried out sympathetically to the historic conservation guidelines.
You have 1 minute.
We do not believe that the points raised here are unreasonable, and we request that all the issues be given consideration prior to any planning commission. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for that. And now if we can move then to residents, which I think I haven't taken your name, so I don't want to introduce you. The petition on behalf of the Residents Association, if you could just introduce yourself, you two will have up to 5 minutes.
Hi, my name's Chris Owen. I'm a resident of Highfield South, Rock Ferry. I've lived in my house, which is almost opposite the gates in Highfield South, since 1984. I've seen good and bad in Rock Ferry come and go, and as part of the Residents Association, we understand there has to be the development on the site. We have no problem with that. We have a problem with is the split between the two roads, which we thought was going to ease the traffic between the two sites. And to give you an idea, Ravens would be taking 38 homes, we're taking 102 in Highfield South. It doesn't seem overly fair. If you move on to volumes of traffic, it becomes hideous after that. You then talk about, most people have two cars that I know of in this day and age. So you times that by two, you end up with 76 cars coming out of Ravenswood, and possibly, on the smallest figure, 194 coming out into Highfield South. Highfield South is used currently as a ramblin'. It's a shortcut. The road's in poor condition, we have a bend at the top of the road, we have two schools at either end. I live on the 29, as I say, smack bang in the middle. We don't go down the end of the road beyond half past two, between 4 o'clock, we don't go the other way for the passing. So those are the problems we're having with volumes of traffic are not split evenly, and the sheer volume, if you take the houses at 76, 8 apartments times 2, 16, you then come to the 102 people living in a nursing home or extra care home. By its very nature, it's going to be low-level care required, so people are going to have cars, and we don't believe 50 parking spaces is enough to cope with the volume. Certainly not enough, because nobody's talked about visitors to the site. They're coming on Saturdays and Sundays. All that traffic, people by the very nature will not go onto a site if they can't get in. They'll double park in the road. We can hardly move now. So we've got 50 parking spaces inadequate. There's a bistro proposed on the corner. Now, people are going to visit that, so there's another set of people. Nobody seems to know how many. Visitors, staff. That varies between, well, we've been told 2 and 10, 15, 20 people. Not everybody's going to walk to work. Those people are going to park their cars on a 50 parking space site. Once you can't get into the site, there's only Highfield South left then to park in. So our major concern is the sheer volume of traffic. I'd say two schools, extra care residents having to come out onto what we consider to be a dangerous road now. And at the end of Nose Highfield South, it's very similar to a Roman road, you know, you can get quite a speed up. The bungalow at the top of the road has had three cars through the gateway and through the front garden. We were asking, as part of the bill, if any form of traffic measurement, traffic calming could be introduced. But it seems that the tourists on one side and the Wirral Borough Council on the other side. And we wait till the bill happens and then we beg for some money from the Wirral Borough Council. So as far as we're concerned, we need some sort of traffic calming to happen. We would like some sort of review of the split of people. We did ask for the car park to be, an overspill car park to be put on the other side of the 102 building so we could measure the two out. But that's where I cease to rattle on. Thank you very much. I don't know if Mike wants to say anything on that at all.
Your petition has 1.5 minutes left of time on it, if you want to transfer it.
As Mike Nijard, also from Residents Association, we've been campaigning for, well, I've been in the road 20 years, for some sort of traffic calming measure. Lord McLaughlin has asked since October, I think it's April 2014, to as recently as October 2019, for some traffic calming measures. That we've not received any support whatsoever from the council. They've claimed that there's a good road safety record on that road. If you lived on the road and you saw the speed of some of the cars, you'd have plenty of concerns. You say there's only been one accident there in the last 5 years, and that was a drunk driver. That's ruled by accident and design, that there's only been the one accident. There is a definite need for more traffic calming, or poor traffic calming on that road. And when you've got the majority of the traffic is going to be coming out of Highfield South entrance from the development, you're going to need even more in the way of traffic coming going forward. And that's it, thank you.
Thank you, Ed. I'm finally now to prepare for Mr. Mellor, Kevin Mellor, who has a petition 35 plans.
Okay, good evening. Dave Mailer here. I've lived in Ravenswood Avenue for 40 years. In July 2019, a petition was started in Ravenswood Avenue, signed by 99% of households, calling on tourists to rethink their multitude of paths on the site that would lead to Ravenswood Avenue becoming a leaky cul-de-sac or leaky dead end. In October 2019, Gareth Jarvis of Taurus told us that he would seek a secure by design accreditation for the site layout. However, in late January, he told us it was up to Wirral Council to obtain the accreditation. Ravenswood Avenue would like secure by design accreditation to be secure prior to planning consent. If the past situation remains as it is, we would like tourists to rail off the paths as shown on my site layout diagram, which I'll give over later. The extra care home facility does not meet the Wirral model for extra care homes. 102 flats exceeds the 50 flat limit of the model due to quality of life and institutional issues. We was told the flats are high quality, yet I have it in black and white from tourists that they are designed to meet the government's minimum space requirements. Any smaller and tourists would be prosecuted. This three-story building will be an eyesore, inconsistent with the grade two listed building. The flats should be scaled back to 50 to meet the Wirral model standards of quality of life. In 2013, the Rock Ferry High site was put on a shortlist for extra care homes. In 2014, Wirral Council obtained planning permission for the demolition of the school, apart from the listed building, which was listed in 2012. The planning permission granted for the demolition was on condition that within 2 months of the grant, A plan is produced for the security and ongoing maintenance of the listed building. Fast forward to 2019 and the tourist surveyor could not survey the building for fear of life and limb. Thieves have been holding cash and carry sales of the roofing materials. Dry rot is extensive. Basement is flooded. Plasterwork destroyed. Wirral Council Cabinet declared it derelict. Why? Wirral Council held four consultation meetings to discuss the site and get the residents' views. Residents consistently called for retirement bungalows and definitely no flats. This galvanised Councillor Moira McLaughlin to organise a No More Flats in Rock Ferry petition and got residents to sign during these meetings. This petition is never heard of again. Why? The minutes of the meeting sent to the Secretary of State for Education contain no mention of the residents' views.
You have one more minute.
Build retirement bungalows and definitely no flats. That's rather strange, is it not? Wirral Council make no mention of the fact that the site is on an extra care shortlist at the meetings, even though it had been on the shortlist since 2013. They went through every fact of why the UTC couldn't be built there and the Isle of Man IT Centre, but kept quiet about the ECH, the extra care home shortlist. Why? Thank you very much.
Thanks. I would normally now invite members of the committee to ask any questions or clarification of petitions, so I'll do that now if members have any questions. If the members have any questions they'd like to put to any petitions.
I've known about this application for a long period of time, as I think many members of the committee have seen it sort of develop. I just want to investigate, because I was told there was a high level of public engagement, both by the developer and local councils, and that's how the Residents Association almost formed as a result of that. So it's obviously clearly organised and have got sort of your views being put forward. I just want to know the levels of consultation that took place prior to it, because we try to encourage developers to talk to the residents where they're going to potentially be a neighbour of and move in. I just want to get some feedback from residents about the level of consultation. I'm aware, certainly, one was very memorable because a good friend of mine, Frank, one meeting Frank had his fell ill, didn't he? I believe at one of the meetings. So I was aware of high levels of consultation. I just want to know whether residents felt they had the views, at least the chance to put the views forward. I guess you may not be happy about it, but all a bit listened to, but the sort of level of consultation, what was it like?
It was fairly crude. And in my world, and from the Residents Association, the biggest disappointment for us was that Frank Field seemed to jump into a completely different camp. He didn't support us in any shape or form. He had a political agenda to follow, so I didn't really understand where he was coming from. And certainly didn't feel he was ever on our side, and neither did councillors. And in fact, one councillor said to me, do you object to any development? I said, no, I don't object to it. I object to rubbish being built. I don't object to people having homes and some sort of quality. And that, so the three meetings we had, which culminated with Frank having his heart attack, were
If I may, I think the question that was being put was about the developers' consultation.
Well, the context of that, the developers were not at any of those meetings.
No, I appreciate that.
Talk about the developer and general consultation.
Yeah.
Yes, when the developers came on board, we were given views and snatches of things, but obviously being developers, I didn't feel we were taken along all the way. We were just shown things every so often.
It's consultation, it's loose and sensitive.
Graham Burgess was the council leader. The chair of Taurus was the council leader.
I want to give everyone an opportunity to answer the question.
They paid lip service to consultation. He made recommendations or observations. It says generally that they've ignored. Yeah, we listen to what you say. That's it.
If I could put in here, the Taurus consultations, the first one basically was a waste of time because it was just artist impressions. And when you wrote something up, they said, well, it's not the final plan. The second one, at the end of the consultation, as Gareth Jarvis had already left, I asked the fellow who was in charge from Taurus, right, we've had 2 hours here or whatever it was. Would you say the majority of the residents that have come here today are in support of your proposals or against? And his answer was against. And that's the most honest thing I've heard from Taurus. Or possibly from the council. Certainly the 4 council consultations were abysmal. As a sign of democracy, it was absolutely shocking. Thank you.
Any further questions or okay, can I thank you for your presentations? Ask you to rejoin if you have the audience or not. Now, okay, so in terms of the time that has been allocated to petitions and objectives, it came to 14 minutes in total. That time is now available to the applicant or their agent. So can I invite the applicant? Okay, my efforts to be scrupulously fair. 14 minutes is the time to take by the objectors. So you will also have 40 minutes to make your presentation and maybe to address some of the issues that have been raised. So you could introduce yourself and
thank you, Chair. I'm Liam Armstrong from Mosaic Town Planning and we're representing the applicant today. The redevelopment of the former Rock Ferry High School site will transform the area into a new community with 76 affordable homes, an extra care scheme for the elderly, and the much-needed conversion of a vacant listed building for 8 apartments. The principle of development is accepted. Although the site is partially designated as a school playing field, this is now redundant and its loss has been justified. You'll read in your report that all technical matters are addressed or can be addressed by planning conditions and contributions. No technical consultees have objected to this scheme. Whilst you may hear some parking and highways concerns for local people, the former use of the site as a school is likely to have generated similar or higher traffic levels. We've shown that the proposal is safe and accessible, and your highways officer agrees with that. The public benefits of the development includes up to 22 new jobs, the use of unsightly derelict land, and relieving pressure on greenbelt release, the renovation of a listed building, bringing it back into use and better revealing its importance to the wider area, a new woodland walk to open up the site to the public and encourage recreational use. And then there are social benefits. Due to an ageing population, we're often reminded of the need to build more accommodation for the elderly. Extra care accommodation provides real benefits to residents, providing a safe living environment, increasing social engagement and quality of life, and the reduction or delay of medical assistance. The housing surrounding the extra care scheme will provide high quality, affordable accommodation to local people. The design of the development will be sympathetic to Ravenswood and the area. All spacing standards are met and a sensitive landscape plan has been submitted, which retains existing mature trees alongside new planting. The stone wall fronting Highfield South is also to be retained. In summary, we believe this development will be an incredible asset for the area and will bring an important site back into use. The scheme complies with local and national planning policies, and you've been recommended by officers to approve this application. I hope you agree today that this is a vitally needed scheme for Rock Ferry and the Wirral. And I'll pass you over to Gareth Jarvis.
Hello, committee. I'm Gareth Jarvis, Development Manager at Torres Homes. Torres is the largest housing provider in the North West, with almost 40,000 homes with deep roots in the Liverpool City region, with a strong, ongoing commitment to the Wirral. We have, in the past 12 months, completed over 130 new homes over four sites in the area, with a further 148 homes in the pipeline across six sites. This proposed scheme would add a further 186 units and strengthen our commitment to adding much needed housing to the Wirral. These developments represent a total investment of over £70 million in the area. This scheme represents a £30 million investment by Torres, with a Homes England grant commitment of £7.5 million. To secure this grant, we require to secure planning, purchase a property and make a start on site for the next few months. We have a local North West contractor on board who is making provisions to be ready for an immediate start following planning approval and land purchase. As part of the build contract, the contractor has to commit to a social value option plan which stipulates the amount of training and apprenticeship places they will have to provide for local young people. Major infrastructure investments such as this proposal also provides Torres with the opportunity to make all of its residents wealthier, healthier, safe and more equal. Torres invests 100% of its commercial profits into our charitable arm, Torres Foundation, to improve the lives of our customers and the wider community, providing services which improve health and well-being and access to training and employment opportunities. Each year we allocate £5 million to the Torres Foundation to help the local need and make a difference to communities. Factors such as health improvement, increased education and skill attainment is incorporated into procurement exercises to bring increased choice and personal development resulting in long-term sustainable community benefits. The extra care facility will provide accommodation for people over age 55 who can live independently with support and personal care packages to suit their needs, and also to avoid moving to residential care. This enables couples with different care requirements to remain living together, and also prevents the loss of skills required to living independently. The community aspect of extra care combats isolation and reduces support on primary and acute NHS services and social care budgets. The community will benefit from increased employment opportunities in the care and housing teams. The scheme likely to generate around 50 permanent employment opportunities. Local businesses also have the opportunity to take in the bistro and salon as preferential cost bases. The extra care, once in operation, will be staffed 24 hours a day. The team will provide access to housing-related support and will work with a care provider appointed by the local authority. The service provides more than standard housing can offer and includes well-being advice, activities to enable people to live well in their older age. We work to build resilient and sustainable communities, investing in our heartlands and the wider North West in the world to provide housing options which meet people's needs and improve their quality of life. Thank you.
I normally invite members to ask questions of clarification. They were already taking some questions, that's right. I wonder if I could just start just by asking, the suggestion was made that 11 trees, I think, are to be lost as a quantum of the development, and in your presentation you mentioned new planting. Are you able to, is it all like for like? Are there going to be more trees on the site after you leave, or less?
I think what I can say is that through the application when it was submitted, it was consulted with the tree officer. There have been discussions between Foulkes and the case officer and the tree officer as well. As you can see by the plan behind you, this is a very green site. We're not talking about removing lots and lots of trees. We can see that there's a woodland on one side which is to be retained and used as a walkway. With some adaptive play features within that. The character of Highfield South will be retained in many ways. The wall is to stay, the trees fronting Highfield South are to stay. The only trees that have been removed are as an absolute necessity of development, and we've worked within the kind of constraints of the trees to provide an adaptive layout, if you like.
Can I ask a second question? Sorry, I was before I was reference was made to a secure by design accreditation. Obviously, in the past, it was a school, so it was completely closed. Are you able to comment in any sense about the security of the site?
We just reduced the design to meet the secure by design criteria. We don't apply for the secure by design until. Planning
and building a site, so we don't have a position to apply for that. Yeah, thank you, Chair. It's on the question of extra jobs, but I think it's been stated that extra jobs would be created as a result of the application. Now, I think I hear two figures, one of 22 and one of 50. Could you clarify exactly what sort of jobs are the permanent jobs, or are you talking about jobs that will be in creation whilst the application is being built for application on that?
For the extra care itself, there'll be around 20 posts, some part-time, some full-time. It all depends on the amount of care some of the people require, and what staffing will be in the bistro and the like. We envision about 20 permanent posts in the extra care. The actual during the construction period, I think I touched on before, the contractor has sent a social value action plan, and in this instance we'll be looking at around 19-20 training and apprenticeships opportunities for local people. We also have work experience opportunities for 18 to 20 year olds, with around about 15, and then we'll also be getting other training opportunities as well.
Thanks, Chair. I've got a couple of questions. I think Mr. Armstrong, if you could, the Chair asked you specifically in terms of the tree planting, whether it was a like for like replacement. I don't think you answered the question, but I may have missed that. Could you confirm?
It is something that we have looked at today, and it's something I specifically asked our tree specialist today. I'm consulting to not a tree specialist, so I'd have to defer to them really, but we haven't got that figure, I'm afraid, no.
That leads on to the second question. You heard from the objectives that you're having some consultation that you've undertaken with